All we're trying to do here is to listen to the song of salvation, which is what's sung by the Holy Spirit, actually. We want to be aficionados of the song of salvation. So I've transferred my penchant to listen to great music over to listening to the song of salvation, because that's the greatest song there is, for sure. There's no other song that can touch this. I listened to it this morning, and what I heard was just staggering. Staggeringly great. Staggeringly wonderful. Staggering clarity. I say, hey, play it again. Let's have it on perpetual replay, actually. So we don't have to keep hitting play. Let's just have it on perpetual replay here. And it's interesting, the ability to listen to something very carefully, like if you're a musician or into music, and you're able to listen to a song with tremendous attention. You hear every little subtle nuance, and you've listened to it 1,000 times. I've listened to a song 1,000 times, and the next time I would hear way more than the other time. And each time I listened to it, I'd hear more and more and more nuances like that. Transfer that ability over to listening to the Holy Spirit, the song of salvation. Just use that ability that you have. Use whatever ability you have to pay close attention and hear more and more and more nuance, more and more nuance. Now, in listening to the song of salvation, it will be rather staggering, as it was for me this morning. But we have to keep our stride going. We don't have much leeway in this world. We never have leeway in this world. There's the world is again extremely distracted. This is really a dance of distraction, this world. So there must be something really, really heavy going to take place soon, because we're getting some heavy, heavy distraction right now. Heavy distraction. Now, it might be something really great. That's possible, right? It might be something really great. Which is why there's a desperate attempt of the ego to distract our attention off onto some sob story, some extreme sob story that riles our emotions up. It gets us fixated and angry and upset, you know, like that kind of thing. So we're not in a proper state of mind to listen to the song of salvation. So I say, don't pay attention to the news. I stay away from the news for sure. Inevitably, a little bit trickles in one way or the other. Someone will mention something like, what's the hell are you talking about? Or, you know, but don't pay attention. Don't immerse yourself. Don't think about any of that news, what's happening in the world. It's truly of no consequence whatsoever. The entire focus is to exchange perception for vision. That's the total focus that we have to have. That is the answer. 100% sure that it is the answer. Exchange perception for vision. Vision of oneness. Vision is vision of oneness. There's no perceiver. There's no need for there to be any perceiver. And therefore the burden of perceiving and being perceived is lifted off of us. Liberation from this great, impossible burden. So our job is to remove the blocks to that and making that exchange. I haven't yet made the exchange. I'm working on it. We have a war coming in this world. We have so much coming in this world that is very distracting. Perception is competition with God, and it's very nasty. The way that it tries to fix its problems are very terrible, very crazy. Let's say there was this person who was a vicious hoarder of money, and they made $1 billion, and they ruthless. And they realize in the eyes, others perceive them as this ruthless hoarder of estates and money or whatever. And that's the person. And they said, "Wow, I need to alter the perception that people have of me." So what they do? What they do is they go to someone and they brainwash, seduce, manipulate, and say, "Look, I want you to have 10 times more money. I want you to have $10 billion. I want you to be 10 times more ruthless than me." And so then they say, "Look, I'm not ruthless. Look at this person. They have $10 billion. They're way more ruthless than I am." See, so they're the bad ones, not me. So perception always tries to make something else worse to alter the perception of how they're perceived. Look at that one, they're worse. See, that's how perception works. Perception is truly, the more you see it, you're aghast at how terrible it is, truly. You don't want it. You want to be freed from it. So it is very possible when you listen to the Holy Spirit to hear the song. It's a song of clarity. You just like listen to it. It's like, wow, this. Phew. You see so much, and it keeps on going. It's like listening to a song. I mean, in like a 5-minute period or something, or 10-minute, or maybe it's a symphony. Maybe it lasts an hour, but you get so much clarity. And you should just be like an audience member, just kind of listening, saying, okay, don't think about it. Don't try to remember what it is. Just keep listening to it. And then it will eventually, it seems to say, okay, that's enough for now. That's what happened this morning. And I'm just like, that's just wow. So much heavy stuff was clarified. I was shown it in clarity this morning. The viciousness of perception. The tears of perception. Oh my God, we do not want to be part of perception. We do not want to be in this game of perception, for sure. Every bit of viciousness that you thought was part of perception, it is. It most certainly is. There's no good side to it at all. It's competition with God. So again, these videos, even more importantly than the insights, etc., is to show the aftermath of the insights, to show that it's okay. Because ultimately, each one of us will have to listen to the song of salvation from the Holy Spirit and get that, you know, 5, 10, 15, 20, half an hour, a couple hours of song that just like, we're just be amazed at the wisdom that you are witness to. And you say, wow, the wisdom exists, that there it's, I'm aware of it. So it's just managing the wow factor as best as possible. It helps keep it keep helps speed it up. So oftentimes the videos are done after I've had this incredible time of listening to the Song of Salvation and just being having this cavalcade, a cascade of deeper and deeper and deeper insights, more and more profound, more and more profound. And it's just exactly the stuff that you want to see and hear. You know, it's just, it's nothing esoteric at all. It's totally basic. Totally basic stuff. It's like, wow. Right, the roots of it, you know, seeing the roots of misery. Now, the song fades away a bit. What's important is to manage the aftermath of that properly. That's what's most important. So the spiritual path is really a class in management. It's a management class in managing the aftermath of listening to the Song of Salvation. Should I say, keep stay in the mood of repentance. That is how you manage it. And realize we have every right to be clear about what our choice is. Our only choice is being perception and vision. There's no other choice we have. None. That's it. And the more you see how awful perception is, the more you lean towards vision. Vision of oneness. Everywhere right now-ness. When you choose vision, you free everybody from perception. Because you're not perceiving them. The experience is not a judgment. Perception is judgment. It's not a judgmental perception. How do you look to me? From this location, no, it's everything is in everywhere. There's only everywhere-ness right now. So you lift the burden of perception off of others. In other words, they're not an object of perception in your eyes. There are no objects of perception. They are still objects, but they're not objects of perception. They are simply the one. Everywhereness, everywhere, right now-ness, is the feeling. So, managing the aftermath of once you hear the Song of Salvation, you need to hear it over and over and over and over and over again. It's like playing a song over and over again. Each time you'll hear more, better and better and better. It's good to have a quiet time after that. Don't get too busy, too frantically active. perception is just a dance of shadows, really. Just a dance of shadows. So as they say, just sitting quietly. Someone asked the teacher, you know, the guru, saying, what's the best advice? Just sit quietly. What they're saying is, that's how you manage your breakthroughs. You're listening to the Song of Salvation. That's how you manage your reaction to it. It's just like this, wow. You're seeing the roots of your misery, where it's coming from. And then, of course, then you're seeing it's possible to set it down, exchange it for vision. And so there's this awareness that eternal life is an option, is a choice, actually, we can make. We exchange nothing for everything. So it's kind of like you're a business person and there's this incredible deal being offered to you. And it's like you can hardly believe it, you know, what a successful business person you're going to be. I just simply made it, you know, you can look at it, I just made a really successful business deal, is what I did. People ask you, well, what happened to you? And you say, well, I made a really great business deal. Was able to, you know, have the nerve to do it. I made this great, great, great deal, business deal. I exchanged nothing for everything. I exchanged perception for vision, vision of oneness. So just a super great, you know, business deal, business transaction. I was able to be a super business person. Which is true. I mean, that is a very apt way to describe it. So this puts us in this firmer footing because the world is all about business, right? As they say, the business of USA is business. So by putting it in that way, I just made a tremendously great business transaction. And people can relate to that. They say, hey, I'd like to do that too. And they say, well, I want to do business with you. He said, no, no, I'm retired now. I'm retired from business. That was my final deal. You make the deal with the Holy Spirit. That's your business partner, is the Holy Spirit, not me. I can certainly advise as to how to do business with the Holy Spirit. But the business is with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one that leads us into vision. Makes the exchange from perception to vision. It's the one that's singing the Song of Salvation. So it's the one you're doing business with, not me. So you too can do a great business transaction. So it's like the Holy Spirit sets the deal on the table and says, here's the deal. And you look at it and you just say, wow, that's too good to be true. Is that true? Is it possible? I mean, really? What do I have to do for that? I mean, nothing. Just accept it. Sign on the dotted line. Just accept it. You mean I didn't need all those memories of perception? No. All memories are perceptual memories. Vision is right here, nowness, always. No perception, vision of oneness. Everywhere right nowness doesn't generate memories the way that we are used to memories, all the painful stuff that happened, all the difficult, terrible, you know, I look back, generates all these awful memories, and we're told this is what builds character, this is what builds a person, this is what makes you a man or a woman, this is what makes you a soul, this is the lessons you need to learn. This is all nonsense, is what it is. That's all the story of perception. Perception has a whole story about why it's necessary. Ultimately, perception is just a competition with God, which is totally unnecessary. God didn't say, hey, Spirit, I created you to compete with me. No. Created us, Spirit, to co-create with God, not to compete. Now, we're free to imagine a competition, but there is no competition. It takes two to compete. God's not competing with us. So there is, we're just competing with ourselves, really. There's no point to it. So we invent all these stories about a soul evolving consciousness, needing to do this and this and this and that. That's just a story of perception. Vision has no such story. And of course, perception says, well, I'm leaving you behind because I want, you're just wandering around aimlessly, babbling about a story that you're following. It's like something just erratically, wandering around erratically, aimlessly, erratically, and all the while telling themselves a story. Okay, now I'm advancing here, now I'm advancing here, now I'm growing, I'm evolving. And it's like that. They just put a narration on top of this aimless wandering. So when we see this deep business deal, we try to see it as it really is, and don't see any value in perception. Because perception always thinks that it can get more. It wants to be perceived in a better light. So it says, how does this help me be perceived in a better light? How does vision help me? No, we're exchanging perception for vision. Don't need perception. Everything is seen in the light of everywhereness. Perception always wants better perception, to be perceived better. At least I want to be able to perceive better, and I want to be perceived better by others. That really means is they want others to be perceived worse than you. You say, I want others to be perceived worse, so I'm not perceived so terribly. Right now, others are perceived to be terribly, so I want others to be perceived to be worse than me, so they're perceived worse, and I'm not so bad in comparison. It's all this comparative struggle, horrible struggle. And those that seem to be more successful at it, they're the ones that invest more and more in perception and become more and more wicked, actually. More and more tricky and cunning and wicked, manipulative. Reign over the kingdom of nothing. They'll look for a kingdom where there's nothing, so they cannot be perceived badly. And they'll invite you into their kingdom of nothing and tell you they're enlightening you. That exchange perception for vision of oneness, the more it helps these lost, those ones that seem to be very lost in the game of perception, in competition with God, is what it is. And they invite you into their game, the ones that are really, really into it. You don't want to go into that. Very bad. If you don't want to get sucked into that game, that game, as is possible to get sucked into it, for sure. So, it's very important to work on managing your reactions to clarity. The Song of Salvation is a song of clarification, and it's so hopeful. It is so hopeful. You just say, oh my God, it's so hopeful. This is fantastic. You have to manage your reactions so that you can hear it again and again and again. Reinforce. It's a path of reinforcement. Listening to the song over and over and over. It's not that you hear it once and say, okay, I now know the truth. I know I got to get everybody to perceive that I know the truth. That's still perception. That's still perception. That's not it. Instead, be humble. Be quiet. Be humble. So that you can hear it again. So it can be reinforced. Repetition. Reinforcement. You know, someone has a peak moment and they run out and write a book about it. Publish the book, and they spend the rest of their lives hawking their book. Say, yeah, I had this breakthrough, you know, I had this clarification. And this is the tendency in the world. This is why you see people saying they're enlightened and writing books, etc., etc. And they've had an experience of a clarification. They heard the song. But they haven't made the exchange yet. You can tell. See, I say I have not made the exchange yet, because I have not. I can talk about this very clearly, but I haven't made the exchange, and it's obviously have not. Obvious. Relatively few, very few, make the exchange here. The tendency is to, at least so far, everyone will have to make the exchange eventually. So, you know, we have to work on that, managing success. As you get closer to making this deal, you realize how great the deal is. And then there's a tendency to think that you can, there's this hope, you can then use it to get yourself to be perceived better. You know, and you try to fit it back into perception. So it's better just to sit quietly, or, you know, gentle talk, or just minimal talk. Because the clarity that you get is so profound, the inclination is, perceptual inclination is to go out and meet with people and impress them about how much you know. Which would, you know, which is really means is to alter their perception of you so that they feel that they exist according to how you in your eye, they exist in your eyes, in your perception. And therefore they want to be nice and good to you so that you have a favorable perception of them. They say, oh, you have a higher perception than I do. So this is how perception works. We're both perceiving everything, and everything's also perceiving us. And so we have this battle, this struggle of we want everything to be perceived by us so that we're like God, right? And then everything else is trying to get us to be perceived by them. So that's this struggle between people, power struggles. You know, there is no peace in perception. There is no peace whatsoever. The idea of world peace based on perception is totally ludicrous. Totally ludicrous. So don't even pay any attention to that. So if you know a lot and you say, hey, and you want to impress someone saying, this is what I know. And so, and they say, oh my gosh, you're so knowledgeable. And they feel like, I want you to perceive me well. I want to be well perceived by you. Because you got higher perception. See? That's like a cult is what happens, you see. There's always all cults are perceptual cults. And the whole world is a perceptual cult. All these power struggles going on constantly. Constantly. And then they tell you if you don't play the game, then you're nothing. Well, there's no perception. I'm everything. I'm everywhere. Not nowhere, I'm everywhere. I have the everywhere nowness feeling. Everywhere right nowness feeling is the feeling. Always. We would say that. So the tendency can be to try and rush out, market, in many different ways. The insights or clarity. Now sharing it is fine. Sharing it is fine. And just, you know, I just do the videos here. Someone wants to watch them, they watch them. Someone doesn't, they don't. I don't go around talking to people like one-on-one or anything like that. As far as all the people that I interact with go, I'm just a nobody. Very low in their eyes, actually. I hold very low status among people that see me. So I have a very low status. I don't say anything, you know, about perception and vision and clarity. I don't say anything. I don't talk about that at all. Talk about the weather, basically. Sports, the weather. That's it. So that's, you know, play the fool is a proper managing. Playing the fool is proper managing of the clarity. And you may have a community of like-minded who can help reassure each one another to keep on working. That's what we're doing here, reassurance. Just keep reassuring, yeah, that this is the path, this is the way. So I'm just offering reassurance and some management tips from experience of how to manage your success. From having long experience of not managing it properly as well as I should, and still working on it, of course. But I would say this is the important emphasis, is managing your success. When you learn to manage it better and better, then the success comes strong, because you can manage it. The Holy Spirit won't give you more than you can manage, really. Now, it's possible to force a momentary breakthrough, etc., in various means and ways that people try to get a peak experience. But the Holy Spirit is not like that. It's a gentle, it's humble, and it wants you to actually succeed in making this exchange. It's not really after peak experiences so much. It's after making this exchange, actually making the deal. Making the deal is what its goal is. It means total, true liberation, not just some peak experience that you know, then you go out and start a cult, write books and start a cult. That's not its objective. So it's had me in a very lowly position, so that the idea of, hey, everybody, look how much I know, people look at me like, you're crazy. See, in their eyes, I'm nothing. So if nothing starts acting like it's a big deal, they'll just say, oh, you're crazy. You're really nothing. Who do you think you are? So that's managed to keep me, you know, very humble, to say I have to keep complete the deal. You know, completing the deal is where it's all at, totally. That's the only goal there is to complete the deal. To complete the deal, you have to see what the deal is. What are you exchanging? What's this for that? Okay. Perception for vision. There's no way at all to make perception work for you or for anyone. No way whatsoever. It's always going to be terrible. That's a fact. And seeing that, you know, you just, wow. It's a little scary, actually, because you're still using perception. And you see just how awful it is, actually. How it generates all these terrible emotions and thinking reactions to these emotions. Perception is an emotional, reactive, thinking situation. Vision is a everywhere nowness feeling, a completely peaceful, tranquil, nirvanic, paradisical feeling, totally steady, calm, no ripples. Intrinsically that way, that's the vision of oneness. It's not emotions, that's perception. Perception generates all sorts of emotions and drama. It's an opera, it's a big opera. Perception is this massive opera, universal opera, of tragedy and triumph and envy and lust and greed and drama of all types of emotions, and hate and love and lust and attraction and repulsion jealousy. It's the operas. Maybe the operas have, that's perception. And perception never changes. That's what it is. It's a frantic struggle with shadows. It's just dancing with shadows. Shadow dance. Trying to have a better shadow than someone else. Okay, so you get phone calls and you have to interact and you got stuff going on, of course. Now, it's difficult because playing the fool is difficult because you realize that you do know, you are more aware than just about anyone you meet. You know, you can see how they're caught in the dance of perception. But you have to pretend that you don't know anything. You have to pretend you don't know anything. And so that is difficult, for sure. And you think, well, how do I go from everyone thinking for sure that it's either perception or vision? That's the only choices we have. It's just a simple choice. Some choose perception, some choose vision. Vision is different than perception. So it's apples and oranges. It's apples and oranges. And when you can see it that way, then there's not a lot of thinking that arises. Not a lot of explanation that arises. Just, I just made the business deal. I'm excited to exchange it. Perception for vision. That's it. And I say, well, how'd you do that? You know, maybe I want to do that. You know, what they really want is they want better perception. I say, I can't help you with better perception. I can't help with, you know, the exchange of perception to vision. Give some tips and advice about that. Apples and oranges. Most people want just a bigger apple, you know, a more glossy apple. So they want to be, they want others to perceive them in a more favorable light. And what they really want is to be others to accept their perception of them as their existence is dependent on their perception, on your perception. So I want to be the big apple where everyone feels that they only exist in the light of my perception, you see. That's what people are going towards. Egomaniacs are those who say, oh, everyone only exists in my perception. And they go through life that way and they develop cults and various situations like that. And people are attracted to that because they say, yeah, that seems to be, if everyone, see, it's playing God is what it is. It's playing God. It's playing God. So most people want a bigger apple, a glossier apple, and they don't really, they think, I'm going to try that first before I think about exchanging for vision. So once they go through that glossier apple, bigger apple, go through these various stages and they realize how it still doesn't work, it's still horrible, terrible, then they start saying, hey, you know, maybe I need to, there's something better, a better option. And then that's the path, you know, really get on the path. So there's always some in the world that are on the path of exchanging perception for vision. There's always going to be some in the world. And as of yet, most are looking for the bigger, glossier apple of perception. That's how it is. So in some ways it's better to be Cinderella in that, to be looked down upon by everyone and play the fool. So you're not tempted to go out and publish a book and say, hey, I had some spirit guide show up and talk to me and tell me about the truth and everything, and I'm really cool. You know, it's better to be the Cinderella where no matter what happens, nobody will believe you're worth anything anyway, so you're not even worth listening to. That's the situation I'm in. People don't feel like I'm not even worth listening to at all. I have nothing to say. So that's actually better, because then your temptation is squashed. Squash, squash, squashed. Like, until Prince Charming is, of course, vision. Vision. That's the metaphor of these fairy tales. Very interesting. But Prince Charming coming along for Cinderella is vision. Vision is looking for those who want to make a deal. And see, Cinderella happened to be the one who was ready to make the deal. Because she said, I don't like my situation. I realize what perception is. Duality. The two stepdaughters, you know, and the evil stepmother, stepdaughters. And she says, wow. You know, this is horrible. My life's terrible. I hate it. And then gradually seeing its perception is the problem. Then Cinderella was ready to make the deal. So vision is looking for those ready to make the deal. So Cinderella gets called again. I'm definitely Cinderella. There's no question about it. Taking care of all the trash and garbage and stuff that you know is beneath those who are have higher perception, higher perceptual, viewed in a better light perceptually. So, yeah, Prince Charming is looking for those who are ready to make the deal. That's it. Vision knows, the Holy Spirit knows, who's ready to make the deal here? Who's been working on this, on managing, you know, their clarity? Listen, who's been listening to Song of Clarity? So, Prince Charming's coming along and everyone's saying, me, I got all these beautiful gowns on, look at me, look how wonderful I am. And Prince Charming does not make a mistake. He says, that's the one who has been listening to the Song of Clarity, Song of Salvation, managing their managing the path, the reactions, staying humble, staying quiet. And they're ready to make a deal. So, make the deal, exchange perception for vision, apples and oranges. You see, Cinderella could never convince the stepdaughters and stepmother that she's worthy of anything. It's impossible, right? So she leaves with Prince Charming with vision. See, perception wants to compete. Perception is competitive in many ways. Not, you know, it's not the obviously masculine, you know, sport competitiveness. Oh no, there's so much competitiveness going on in subtle ways, cunning ways, sneaky ways. Super, super competitive perception. Frantically so. Obsessively so. And so they say, Cinderella, you can't compete with us. And she said, I don't want to. I'm not interested. I said, nah, you just because you can't. You're just a low soul, you know. You got to evolve a lot. You're just a maid. You're just a slave. You know, she says, no, but well, I won't argue with you, I won't compete with that. Because if you speak, you know, truth to people, they'll feel that you're competing with them, and that you're trying to get them to be an object of your perception. And they want you to be an object of their perception. So as you start saying that you're more clear than they are, they feel as if you're turning the tables on them. Instead of you being an object in their perception, they're turning into an object of your perception. So like you're turning them to stone or objectifying them. So they want to turn you to stone, and they don't want to be turned to stone. So there's competitiveness. Who's turning who to stone? Everyone, perception is a Medusa's head that everyone is holding as they go around the head of Medusa. I'm turning you to stone, we say, and you know, as we have all these superstitions and warding off evil and all stuff, because we don't want to be objectified. We want to objectify others instead of being objectified. That's the battle, that's the battle. You hear the gender wars, the social culture wars, everything has to do with who's objectifying who. That's all. And it's constantly changing. But the sum total is, the struggle and conflict is the same. Because those who are being more objectified, they don't like that, and they're working frantically to turn the tables and objectify others. And so there's never any peace in perception. Never any peace in perception. What there is those who want to objectify others try to institutionalize that and turn everyone into stone. Regulations, controls, severe imprisonment, severe punishments. Get everyone, you know, objectified according to how they want to. So that they seem to be God and that everyone's an object to them, object of their perception. And so there's this frantic efforts, which is what's going on in the world now. Fourth dimensional matrix wants to objectify the third dimensional dimension and say that the third dimension is merely an object in the consciousness of the fourth dimension, and that the fourth dimension is God, is the highest consciousness, and third dimension is just an object in that, you know, is objectified, it's just an object. That's what's taking place in the world right now. But those who are objectifying that way, who feel that way, they feel terrible, of course. And they're never going to stop struggling to turn the tables. And then the objectifiers then say, well, let's just kill everybody. But of course, if they kill everyone, there's nobody to objectify. They don't feel like they're God anymore. So they don't want to do that. They just want to get rid of everyone that won't worship them, won't accept the objectification, and then create a race of people who do accept their objectification. They just want to get rid of the bad slaves, you know, that kind of thing. But the slaves are always restless, see. No spirit wants to be objectified like that. But perception is this, so it's constant turmoil. Perception is constant turmoil. That's all it is. Constant, bitter ashes. And of course Cinderella, what she did, she had to deal with all these bitter ashes that were constantly generated, like, oh, you don't, here, just make people happy with their objectification. That's the job that Cinderella had, the stepdaughter, stepmother and stepdaughter said, Cinderella, your job is to make everybody happy, accept the objectification that they have, that we're giving them. You know, clean up all the dead stuff. Clean up all the nasty stuff. Make people happy that they're objectified. Get rid of their restlessness for us. It's a totally thankless task, isn't it? Dealing with the cinders. You know, the failures, the losers, those who've been crushed by this objectification, you know, burying them. You know, cleaning up the scene of the crime for the criminals, so the criminals aren't seen as criminals, so to speak. That's what Cinderella is doing. Take out the trash. So that those who are playing God can feel that, oh, look at my happy subjects. Look what a wonderful place I have given them. What trash? Everything's fine. What death? I don't see anything dead here. Everything's nice. Everything's bright, shiny, clean, new. Meanwhile, Cinderella's taking care of all the toxic waste, you know. The biohazard, the burying the homeless and trying to help the drug addicts and now it takes two to tango, so those who are being objectified, of course, they're only being objectified because they want to objectify others too. See, perception, that's what perception is. So in other words, they want to win. So if you want to win, you're gonna have the option of losing too. It's duality. So if you want to be a winner in perception, someone else is going to be a loser. So the very belief that in winning in perception, you're also accepting the possibility you could lose. So sometimes you're a winner, sometimes you're a loser. And that goes on and on and on and on. What you're trying to do is trying to be a winner all the time. It's never possible in perception. Because you always feel that you are being subtly objectified. And you always feel as if something's out of your reach and you can't really, truly win. You can't truly win. There's always a sense that you're about to lose or you're not really a winner. You're not really a winner. You're not really getting what you want. No matter how much you seem to be winning, You still seem to be a loser. And then you'll think, hey, maybe I just need to be a perfect loser. You know, you can't keep it stable because you're restless. You need to compete more. You say, I need to get a bigger victory, so let's take on a bigger struggle here. It goes on and on and on. Worse than can be imagined is horrible, actually. So again, Holy Spirit vision is looking for those who want to make a deal. And it's helping mentor those who in that direction, everyone in that direction who wants to go in that direction. Whatever little willingness we have, we get mentored from within to go towards making that deal. And oranges. And people may go to you and say, oh, you got great perception. That's wonderful. You know, I want you to help me out. What they mean is they want to be perceived greatly. They want to have great perception where they can objectify everyone. But you have to say, no, I don't have any perception at all. Have vision. Vision is not perception, actually. You can play with words if you want and say it's pure perception or something, but now it's better to just call it vision. Differentiate it from perception. Because in no way does it have anything in common with perception that, you know, we're dealing with at all. As far on a feeling level of feeling. No. One is fear, the other is love. There isn't any combination of that. We either are feeling fear or we're feeling love. That's it. We're either perceiving or we have the vision of oneness. We either have perception or the vision of oneness. So when you're aiming for vision, the world of perception thinks you're aiming real low. They only see it in terms of perception. They're unaware of vision. So they say, wow, you really are not very ambitious. You're not really aiming for any high position. You must be just a lowly person, you know, unambitious person. So they see you as lowly slave, basically. No ambition to objectify others, and so you end up being objectified to the max. They think, you know, you're a low person, you're just getting started, you're just a little, you know, child, you need to develop your strengths of ego strengths, you know, perception strengths, objectification strengths. And people in this game, they know the game. So even the ones that are very powerful in objectifying others, in other words, their presence, the charisma, people feel as if they're being objectified in their presence. They feel, and then what they feel is like, oh, I need them, this powerful person, I need them to see me in a positive light. And the light of life is coming from them, their perception of me. That's my life, that's how you feel. Even these powerful people, there are those where they feel objectified and they need to bow and say, oh, I'm nothing without your perception of me, I'm nothing. And then they feel, and then they get favorable from this more powerful personality, ego personality. It's like that. It's like this whole corporate hierarchy like that in perception. And so, of course, everybody's frantically trying to be the boss. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. Objectification. Doesn't matter. Young boss, old boss, female boss, male boss, it's all the same. It's all objectification. It's this chain of objectification. And you're desperately trying to climb the ladder too, so you feel that others are getting their sense of identity from you. See? They're deriving a sense of identity from you, from your perception. And you'd rather have that than feeling you're deriving a sense of identity from others' perception of you. Because then you feel very needy and clingy and insecure and like, I need to please you. I need to please you. You feel like a slave. So you want to get out of that slave thing. You want others to feel that way, that they need to please you. See? So it's a desperate game of belief that identity is up for grabs, that it's vulnerable. Whereas in the vision of oneness, there's no vulnerability whatsoever to identity. None. And I greatly prefer to see that way. In the glimpses of the vision of oneness, I say, oh, I greatly prefer this to this horrible struggle. I mean, everybody has equal, one shared identity. It's totally invulnerable. So all these ego games are not even present at all. What a relief that is. Hate the ego games. Hate them so much. Always have. Just don't want to play them. Don't want to play them. But you have no choice. As long as you're choosing perception, you have no choice. If you don't want to play the game, you'll end up on the bottom for sure. So it's either you end up on the bottom or you choose vision. Cinderella's on the bottom of society there, of status, and she chose vision, saying, wow, it's either vision or this. So I'm like on the brink of actually falling into the absolute dregs of society, the absolute dregs of it. I'm already close to it, but there's still an even lower position. Of, you know, pity, scorn and pity of being so lonely. And so it's either that or vision. And the problem is the will to try and assert myself in perception again is not there. I think, well, you know, I should be able to advance myself back up status-wise. I used to be very high status. And I said, well, I did it before, I can do it again. But the will is not there anymore because I know it will only collapse. It'll be under a severe attack and stress and death and everything that comes with it. So I don't have the will to do it. So I'm not able to pull myself up by the bootstraps status-wise. I'm not able to do it anymore. That's scary. So it's either the dregs, absolute dregs, or vision. You know, that's the choice I have. So, but vision is such a incredible, wonderfulness that, you know, it's hard to go from the dregs of society to this wonderfulness. You know, it's like, wow, it's a continuity issue. So, need to get it resolved quickly. Because if you refuse to play the game, then literally you just drop into non-status. If you don't bow to the objectification of something more, someone more powerful, perceptual power, then they see you as you're nothing. And they tell others you're nothing. If you see them as something, then you lose status in their eyes, you see. It's a vicious system, perception. Very vicious, ruthless, merciless, very merciless, very ruthless. And the nonsense about, oh, we have a kinder, gentler boss here, is nonsense. That really means even more ruthless. When you hear that, you should translate that. You should be wise to the language of perception. When you say you're getting a kinder, gentler boss, a more compassionate boss, etc., what it means is you're getting a more ruthless boss, a more merciless boss. That's what it really means. Look out. Look out. I much prefer a boss that says, hey, I'm a real SOB, you know. I am an SOB boss, no question about it. You know, that's better, actually. The cards on the table, you know. But when the boss comes and says, oh, I'm so nice and more compassionate and kinder, I'll be a much better boss, you know. Look out. You're about to find out just how ruthless perception can be. As we're finding out, of course, and people know know this. They know it. Everything I say, and everybody knows. I know that everybody knows everything, all this, but they haven't worked on their continuity problem sufficiently. Is the only difference. So they haven't evaluated the deal that needs to be made. Perception for vision. They haven't evaluated it, but they do know. Like, I'm not saying anything that people don't really know. You know, you've been around the block enough times, you're aware of the fangs of perception. It's just you think, you don't realize there's an alternative. So the only difference is how close are you to making the deal? You know, that's the only real difference among anybody here. How close are you to making the deal that has to be made? Or have you made the deal? If you've made the deal, then obviously there's a difference there. It's an apple and orange thing, obviously. So we all know at some level, you know, the viciousness of perception. We just don't know what to do about it. We just think, well, I just gotta win. Be obsessed if I just more obsessed with winning and being nicer, win nicer, then everybody will accept their objectification, that kind of thing. See, that's the problem with the quote unquote nice bosses. More compassionate, kinder, more inclusive, more understanding, more on consensus, all these qualities you hear, you know, about we've got a better boss coming in. Let's elevate this new style of boss. You see, now they just think that they can win more with this approach. So they'll actually, you'll find yourself enslaved even worse. Because they say, people won't mind me winning so much because I'm able to present this smiley, kind, sweet face to them. So I'll just win. You win even more. Whereas if you got a boss who's an SOB, you can say, hey boss, you know, I hate this stuff. You're an SOB, and the boss will say, yeah, I know I am. Say, well, I look, you know, I don't want you winning this. That's terrible. And the boss will say, says, yeah, I know I'm a heavy-handed boss, and so I can understand, you know, you're not liking this. And so there's some parameters there. There's some pushback, some parameters. But if you got this cute, smiley, loving, sweet, compassionate, consensus-building boss, you know, they think, oh, I can do no wrong. I'm not a bad boss. So all the win, objectify. Oh, that's good for them. That's not hurting them. So they cannot stand any pushback. They say, oh, I got zero tolerance for pushback because I'm such a great boss. Why should I suffer any pushback? That's not right. That's not fair. That's discriminatory. That's against me. I'm a nice boss. So they objectify even worse. See, the SOB boss, they know they're an SOB, and you can call them on it. And there's some level of respect there. You know, there's some, hey, you know, it's like the respect among criminals. You know they're criminals. And you say, you're a criminal. I say, yeah, I know. Well, I hate what you're doing. Yeah, I know. I know you hate what I'm doing. So there's not this pretense that there shouldn't be any pushback. I say, I'm pushing back. Well, yeah, I know you're pushing back. So, you know, that's better. It's better. It's better to have a petty tyrant SOB boss system. And that's what Don Juan in Carlos Castaneda's books talked about, that petty tyranny is actually a way better situation than this so-called velvet glove nice tyranny. Sweet, kind, compassionate, inclusive, empathetic tyranny. That's worse. It's way worse. That's the fourth dimensional tyranny. It's way worse. Way worse. You feel guilty to push back. You feel wrong. You feel you're bigoted, sexist, racist, ignorant, intolerant, discriminatory if you push back. You know, there's zero tolerance to any pushback. And yet all the while you're being turned into stone, being objectified. Worse and worse and worse. And you feel like you can't push back. So it's way worse tyranny we're going into right now. Way worse. This is my advice to everybody. Because if you push back against a heavy-handed SOB boss, you know, and pow, they hit you, and you say, oh, man, you hit me really hard. I hate that. And the boss says, yeah, I did hit you really hard. I know I'm pretty bad that way. Not that they're going to stop doing it, but at least you have some pushback, and you don't feel so guilty about it, you see. That's important. That's important. It's actually a grace to be living in a place where the bosses are these petty tyrants. That's actually a grace. What's way worse is to be living in a benevolent, tyrannical, compassionate dictatorship. That's way worse. Which is why I say the world's getting worse. It's going into a stone age. It's not getting better. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. The new boss is way worse. Way, way worse. Because dissent will be completely squelched. Because they'll say it's unjustified, it's unreasonable. They say, well, look, hey, look, I'm way better than the previous boss. So you should be happy. But no. Petty SOB tyrant bosses are better than the sweet, compassionate, inclusive, how could I do anything that you wouldn't like type of boss. They are worse. Because they have zero tolerance, and any pushback, they automatically want to turn you to stone. Saying, oh, you're a rebellious slave. See, what they want to do is they want to run a happy plantation. They want the slaves to be happy. But how can you be happy in perception? You cannot. How can you perceive happiness? You cannot perceive happiness. They're telling you, no, I will teach you how to perceive happiness. So I'm just a benevolent teacher. You're my benevolent students, and there's no room for any dissent or restlessness here. Because how could there be? I'm such a great, wonderful teacher. I'm so benevolent for you. That's worse, way worse, because perception cannot be perceived. Oneness cannot be perceived. So the attempt to do so inherently gives rise to this frustration, feeling of you're being deprived. And yet there's zero tolerance to complain about this feeling of deprivation under the benevolent dictatorships. So we're going into this benevolent dictatorshipness. Is way worse. That's why I've been warning people. I've been warning people my whole life, we're going into a worse situation. Don't throw out the situation that I grew up in. So, yeah, it was rough, more rough and tumble, and You know, and there were these SOB bosses and people, but they could tolerate dissent. You could tolerate some pushback. You didn't feel so guilty, you see. And there's some room there to say, hey, wait a minute, and to contemplate, etc. But now, I said, hey, now what we've gone into is way, 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 way worse than what we had before. All the while, we're being told we're going to something vastly better. Because they'll say, guess what? You won't need to rebel and dissent because you won't have any dissent. Why won't you have any dissent? Well, because we won't tolerate it, because it's not necessary. It's this dualistic mind trap. We're being put into a prison. And what they say, well, there is no dissent because the bosses are all now these wonderful, sweet, kind, compassionate, inclusive, tolerant, open, consensus-building bosses, the new boss. So there can't be any dissent about that. Everyone's happy about that. So any dissent is not dissent, it's insanity. You see what you're saying? So what I'm saying is, so what's going on is we're literally generating this massive, massive definition of insanity. We're saying any dissent is actually insanity. Any pushback is actually insanity. This is exactly where we're going. We're almost there. So ultimately you won't be called racist or sexist or bigoted or intolerant or all these terms. Those will all be folded into just one classification of insanity. You're suffering from insanity. Because only the insane could be unhappy about how much better these bosses are than the previous bosses. This is the madness of perception. So, from my perspective, we are entering a stone age, an incredibly dark period. The dregs, the absolute dregs. Of course, in pointing this out, I'm seen as the dregs, because I'm unenlightened. See, I don't get it. According to them, I don't get it at all. And actually, I get it. I totally get it. With the one proviso that making the deal for vision, that is the true totally getting it. But I'm just short of that. I don't want to be short of that, because I see that it's a way worse situation now. Fourth dimension is a terrible, terrible place. Terrible mindset, terrible matrix, where dissension is insanity. Literally, that is their whole shtick. Okay. Third dimension is not that way. You get an SOB boss, they tell you to do this stuff. They say, hey boss, you know, I hate your guts. And the boss says, I know. They might laugh and say, well, nothing you can do about it. They say, yeah, I know. I hate it anyway. The boss says, well, just do your work. And they don't say you're insane. No. You can be angry, you can be upset. You say, well, I want something better. But you're not classified as insane. You say, hey, boss, you're a real SOB. And the boss says, I know. That's true, I am. They don't say you're insane. So at least you have some dignity, respect. You say, hey, you know, I'm sane to feel unhappy. And then the boss says, yeah, okay, I know you're unhappy. I know I treat you like dirt. I know you got to do this. And I know you're unhappy. Life's tough. Nobody says it's a bed of roses. You know, that's what you get. Nobody says a bed of roses. You don't have to like it. Whereas in fourth dimension, you're told if you're not happy, if you're not liking this new management boss setup, then you're obviously insane. And either you need termination, the physical body needs termination, or you need to have genetic splicing done on you, or you need, you know, medication or something. But you're insane. Period. No ifs, ands, or buts. You are insane. End of story. That's the fourth dimension. So which is better? Third is way better. Third dimension is way better. Now, it seems more brutal and rough and tough, and yeah, well, life's not a bed of roses, is it? But you got your saint. And that's it. There is no discussion. Period. And I said, we have all this mechanism to deal with all these insane. The fourth dimension has all these mechanisms to deal with the insane, because they intrinsically label everyone who doesn't agree that they're happy as insane. So of course they have a massive focus on dealing with the insane. You know, re-educate them, you know, there's therapy for the quote-unquote therapy for them. That's their thing. The new mafia, our thing, you know, Cosa Nostra. Fourth dimension is one vast Cosa Nostra, which says anyone who doesn't like what they have to offer are insane. That is their viewpoint. Pretty scary viewpoint, isn't it? Most definitely. So I've felt all along my life, I've realized that the way I am is slowly and surely being defined as insane by the hive mind. And so, of course, I'm worried, you know, because I know that I'm not insane. But once you're labeled as insane, the pressure then to act according to their labeling of you or defining of you becomes so strong that you begin to act out for them the way that they want you to act, which is to act insanely. So you see, that's the scariness of it. You don't want that for sure. But that's the pressure they put on. That's why you see people suddenly acting out. The fourth dimensionals are producing that. They're the ones who are producing that. The acting out can be on a global scale, it can be planetary, solar system, galaxy, universe. They'll suddenly feel the universe has suddenly become insane, is acting out upon me, you know. Oh, it could get that bad. The fourth dimension is a very bad trip, where the acting out becomes way bigger than a person acting out. You see these people snapping and acting out. Often males, they're snapping and acting out. It's because the collective fourth dimensional hive mind pressure on them, saying you have to be happy or else you're insane. They start believing that they're insane, and then they snap and they act out like that. Well, that goes on to a much greater scale than just a person snapping and acting out. You can have much more bigger dynamics than that, snapping and acting out. So the fourth dimension ends up facing enormous problems. Because for a while it seems like everything's getting better because everyone seems to be happy. What they don't realize is they're driving all this defining so much as insane and insisting it is insane, that at some point they come face to face with this massive insanity, this monstrous insanity, and they don't know what to do about it. They flee back to the third dimension is what happens. And that's the cycling of existence, The problem with the fourth dimensionals is if you say you're not insane, then they feel that they're being objectified by you as insane. See, it's either you're insane or I'm insane in the fourth dimensional, which is trying to take the perception to its logical conclusion. It's either you're insane or I'm insane. You know, we can't both be sane, is what the fourth dimensionals say. In other words, there isn't some total sanity, but yes, there is. Vision of oneness, everything is totally sane, without the possibility of being otherwise. So that is, it is the remedy for the madness of perception, the third and fourth dimensional cycling. And the pressure is on so many third dimensionals to commit suicide, to act out that they're insane, you know, that they're not happy with the fourth dimension. They must be insane. Therefore, the thing that insane people do is what they do, they kill themselves, you see. So there is that pressure. A lot of people are feeling very suicidal. They're feeling a lot of anxiety. Terrible anxiety, depression, suicidal feelings. They're not happy being turned to stone, you see, so they must be insane. So I tell the Holy Spirit, play that song again, that song of salvation. Play it again, come on. Play it again, play it again, play it again. But what's the fear? Well, the fear is of being labeled as insane. But remember, what the fourth dimensions are trying to do is trying to get you to commit suicide, to agree to it. Whereas if you don't agree to it, no, you won't feel suicidal. You don't have to feel suicidal. They're just insisting that you do. But if you have the vision of oneness, you won't feel suicidal. Now, the fourth dimensionals may avoid you like you don't exist. That's okay, because you're not objectifying them in any way. Nothing's being objectified perceptually. So it doesn't bother you. Who pays attention, who doesn't pay attention, that is not an issue. Because you are feeling the oneness. No matter what perception is imagining, it doesn't matter. Okay, so this is what's happening. This is what's up in the world. This is what's really going on. This is the pressure the world's under. So I'm trying to help relieve pressure on so many here to realize they have an option. They don't have to accept that they're insane. Do not. It's apples and oranges. Apples and oranges. It's not that you're some weird apple. No, you're an orange. Vision, not perception. It's not like you have some terrible perception problem. No, you don't have a perception problem. You have vision. It's not perception. Perception is something we've imagined as a way to compete with God. That's all it is. It's honoring our desire to compete with God. It makes it seem like plausible that we some experience of competing with God, except God's not competing with us. So, but that's all it is. It's our desire to compete with God. That's all it is. And so you can drop that desire to compete with God. That's not insane to drop that desire, because God's not competing with us. There is no competition. There is no competition taking place. We're just imagining it as we compete with one another. We're imagining this is like competing with God, right? We have somebody who symbolizes God. We're all objectified under that perception, and then we're competing with that to see maybe we can overthrow that, you know, and then make them objectified under our perception. And so it's just a silly game of competition. But we're not competing with God. There is no competition taking place. Okay, so I'm going to keep trying to listen to the song of salvation today. Very important. And I advise everybody to do the same. And manage your success. Manage your success. Okay, that's it. Very good, that's it.